you were working as a shock absorber between the demanding donors and Swami Manmathan on the other hand. How did that experience go? What were the highlights? Or
that experience goes where one of the donors, a wonderful lady and a dear friend to this day, would sort of say to me, again in language I can't use on camera, but you should have been a bloody diplomat, and you should have joined the Indian Foreign Service, you know, and you should have been our ambassador in Timbuktu or something. Because trying to play this middling role between Swamiji and donors with their crazy demands, and Swamiji were, well, if you don't like what I've done, you take this cowshed, put it on your head and go away. You know, take your cowshed on your head. So that was a tough call, and that is why up to date I keep saying, trying to do some of that work for Swamiji, getting him a very practical, on the ground, CPMI kind of person, activist, and the donor world or the Sarkari world, and trying to make these two worlds understand each other, I want nothing but the Bharat Ratna for that, you know, to try to keep that all together. Yeah, that was a tough call. And
is it true that at one point, when you were pressed too much by Swamiji, you returned the project to a donor? Mm. And then Swamiji said, what? Did you do that? Would you like to talk about that incident? To illustrate this relationship you and Swamiji?
You're always trying to get Swamiji to understand some realities that existed. And that if you don't meet some of giving to Caesar that which is Caesar's, I'm not talking about, as everybody today in the development world compromises themselves. No, fight your fights. But there are certain realities that if you don't spend money on time, or if you don't spend money and whatever it is, the other side has problems. And then I'm talking here about Save the Children Fund, which is perhaps the partnership between Save the Children Fund and the directorship at that jamana of James Campbell and Sir Robert Fawkes and Minty Pandey and things. That relationship between SCF and SBMA, I think, demands to be a case study on its own of what is perfect partnership. But even in those perfect partnership relationships, there were moments when ne'er the twain shall meet, you know. And Swamiji wasn't an easy human being to deal with. I think he appeared so complicated to a lot of people because he was so straightforward and so simple that certain realities of life just weren't realities to him. They didn't qualify as realities. I mean, I saw Swamiji, he was a totally practical man who breathed and lived what he believed. There was a woman commissioner once in Garhwa, and here was this very prim and proper, I think she was a spinster also maybe, prim and proper commissioner of Garhwa, with these funny little toys that look like, dogs that look like toys. And she was being very IAS Babu in standing at the side of her car, and all of the people flitting around, you know. And Swamiji was berating her. And so, madam, and this is Madam Commissioner. Madam, if you would pay more attention to the children of this region, instead of these stupid dogs that you walk around with, kuch kaam bhi ho sakta hai. Madam Commissioner didn't know which end it had come from, you know. So, but that kind of madness around, and Swamiji calling a spade, I used to also fight with him, he said, kya yaar, tum logon ko nimantran karta hai, tere function mein aana. तुम उसको स्टेज पे डालता है, इट्स नॉट देयर एंड देन यू गिव देम अ हार्ड टाइम व्हेन दे आर स्टैंडिंग ऑन दैट स्टेज. तो सच तो बोल रहे, काम तो नहीं हो रहा है तुम्हारे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में या कमिश्नरी में. बट इट्स बिट अनफेयर बिकॉज ये क्या करेंगे, यू नो अब यहाँ पर बुलाया गया एंड गाली भी खा ले. बट आई थिंक योर क्वेश्चन वॉज कि problems between officialdom and the reality on the ground. And Manmathan was a very rough and ready kind of person who had the clothes on his back. He didn't, I can't even say that he had food because he got it where he could get it. So he was very basic. And so to keep these things together and keep Swamiji in touch with officialdom sometimes made it very difficult. And he came to the point, even with somebody like, say, the children, that this is awesome, but this is not. So I was in Delhi once and with these lovely people, James Campbell, you know, I said, humse nahi hota kyunki tum bhi pagal hai aur wo bhi pagal hai. Because that's another story, how SEF and SBMA, James Campbell, total lunatic, Swami Manmathan, perhaps 2 degrees more of a lunatic. और ये लोग ऐसे सपना देखते थे, ऐसे काम करते थे, ऐसे बात करते थे. And I'd be sitting with my pencil at the side and then going home and then coming next morning. I said, you have a little fantasy that you do and you're asking me. You know, this costs so many lakhs of rupees. और एक तरह से स्वामी जी pretending to look the other way. Campbell saying, is that for real? It's going to cost so much. I said, yes. Maybe it won't be such a problem. That catch my hair, tear it out, ki kya bolu in logon. So it was this kind of a very sincere relationship. But then I went into the Save the Children office and said, humse nahi hota hai. Aap logon ka beech mein aise ping pong ban rahe hai ki main pagal hone wala hai. So, look. And Jamie Campbell, what is it? Anyway, Manmathan hears about it and Manmathan also freaks out, but it helped bring everybody to a reality check. Okay, this is not much fun to be everybody's doormat or nonsense and aapas mein ladao, aapas mein karo, main to jaake apna bakri bhains ko dekhenge aur aap apna kaam karo bhai. Yes, that's true. It was the only way to resolve that problem that Swamiji was. Get Swamiji to understand this. And Swamiji seemed to me, get them to understand this. So that wasn't easy.
Many people believe that Swamiji was rather rough in his dealings with people and even with people very close to him. He was very rough. For example, I believe once you were walking from the office and there was a huge gadha dug there and you were walking on the edges very carefully. You had a lantern in one hand, files in the other hand, and you slipped and fell in that gadha. And all Swamiji Rector said was, whoever asked him to walk with a lantern in one hand, files in the other hand. So was he always like this with you, or did he ever show appreciation also for what you were trying to do? And how did this relationship go? Was there ever any point when you thought that you had had enough of his madness?
No, there was never a point of, because it was my madness also, you know, like, wo to hai, I say. I know that most of these people who claim to be great devotees of Manmathan and friends of him and movement partners and all the rest of it, I, with my own 2 ears, would hear them so many times when they would visit the ashram, and within 24 hours, they were looking for the next bus out of town. They could not, and they used to say, how do you put up with him, you know, how do you live with him, kind of thing. Actually, living with him and putting up with him was very easy. But yes, he was very rough. He always had a cross face. There was no choice for him, because I used to think, this poor man is having to live inside of his body. And unless he keeps this kind of an attitude to shove and push and carry on and carry on and carry on, he's not going to get anywhere. So he was very rough. he could appear extremely rude. It's just he didn't have time for niceness. But Manmathan can be best, he was a Keralite and he is a coconut. I used to say it to him, you know, very rough from the outside, but from the inside, pure soft fruit and milk, you know. So if you could sort of keep that in your mind, and if you could, he used to draw a Lakshman Rekha around himself, which if you dared to step inside, you would discover that he's not this horrible person that most people thought he was. A very difficult person to put up with.
Is it true that sometime he would cook for you, make coffee or something and bring it to you for breakfast or something?
He wouldn't come and bring it, but when he knew that he was too much work had piled up on me, and I would...
So how do you see Swami Manmathan's legacy working out in present day scenario?
You know, legacies are very easily and very quickly forgotten. But it is encouraging to see this man and the movements he led. Or as I say, the legacy is SPMA is still there. So thank God the legacy seems to carry on. I wouldn't say in a much diluted form, but somewhere along the line I think we have to accept it's not enough to just throw out naras, Swami Manmathan Amar Rehe. And that doesn't add up to anything else. You think about you doing yourself something that matches up, if you like. These are kind of people to emulate. I never looked at Manmathan as some kind of a guru figure. He was a dear friend. He used to enjoy the concept of partnership. I remember him one time coming back quite excited when he had met this very famous gentleman, Saklani Saab. Arey, I saw Saklani Saab in tea today, and he referred to, "Maine aapka partner ko mila tha parson." He had met me somewhere or something. And Manmathan was genuinely animated about the fact that Saklani ji had referred to me as his partner. So, because those are the kind of things, so many times I would hear people address him in terms of, "Swamiji, I want to join you. I want to aapka sapna ko pura karne ke liye." Nothing would annoy him more than that. And he would always beg and plead, "Ki suniye, tum apna sapna ko pura karo, aur main apna sapna ko dekhenge, you know. If you want to help, then there is a pile of bricks that you can go and organize, or there are lots of stones in that field, pick them up and put them in a corner, sapna pura ho jayenge, you know." He was a very practical human being. So his legacy, I think, lives on. I think that we were very, I'm very proud of it, and I don't want to play down any role of mine or anything like that. I just felt, otherwise you could not, nobody, a challenge, nobody could put up with a Manmathan in terms of living with the man for more than 24 hours. If you did not have a sense of being, belonging, being a partner, in a trip together. As I said earlier, Manmathan never came in the way. He would shout and scream and stand on his head and give you dirty looks and things like that. But it came to the point of, "Why do you come all the way back from Delhi to tell me these things and take my signature and then go running again? Arey, my signature is only a big M with some kind of nonsense in the middle of it. Just do it, you know." So he was a, long before Nike, Manmathan had a, "Let's just do it, you know, just do it." So we were very natural partners, I think, in many, many ways. I'm a big pain in the neck for a lot of the young ones who are around me. I certainly played the role with Manmathan. He was a very, like in a good old Hindi, Indian movie, film, the father is a very stern, strict, horrible person kind of thing, and the mother is all soft and gentle, etc. So I tried to play that role as much as I could to save the kids from getting tattooed or even giving a slap across their bum kind of thing. So I think we were very natural partners and we were very lucky to be that way. So his legacy, I do believe, lives on. Because people, even though it's now sort of, people just remember maybe once or twice a year Manmathan. But it's not so important to remember the individuals. But if I keep asking donors today, I keep asking kids and teams today, what will Uttarakhand remember you for? You know, so you can't ignore the existence of Manmathan. Every time a university will come up, or animal sacrifice will come up, or water movements will come up, or saving the environment will come up, whilst they seem like all very archaic movements, these are things that Manmathan fought for 40 years ago. You know? So I think your work, you leave your work behind you, and if it's done something for someone, and I think we have to accept, and I think the world, whether it likes it or not, accepts that almost anywhere you go in Uttarakhand, SBMA or Swami Manmathan's work will come to the fore. And if young people today are to remember anything from his legacy and put it into their own characters and personality, is that sense of commitment. There is none today. The sense that money will not buy everything, you know, unless you give a part of your being, unless you invest yourself in what you're doing, unless you believe in what you are doing. Aajkal ki corporate ways of doing work, and it's too easy. There's a 9-to-5 culture. No, this is, if you're into this kind of work, then you're into this kind of social development work, and it is 24/7. It is your way of life. It's not something you can turn on and turn off. And regrettably, in today's world, we are seeing the voluntary sector at its lowest level. We are seeing government all fractured and uncoordinated and scattered, and vested interests tabita. But then the vested interests used to be the Mahajan and those kind of exploitive kind of energies. But today everybody is a vested interest. For 5 rupees more, somebody will dump his job with you and go and join somebody else. There is no commitment. There is no attitude to life. Social work today is now sepanch. Now, what can you do between 9 and 5? I don't know. So that way, you may feel that the legacy didn't hold. But I think the fact that if you want anything done, then what you leave behind in memories, nobody can ignore the many movements that he led, and the reasons that the ashram and he were behind those movements is very clear. And there are many lessons, many things. Swamiji had a very harsh, as you earlier asked, attitude to people, very rough, very uncompromising, but that was all to motivate people that you can do more, you can do more. So sometimes I also, with my Videshi attitudes in the past, used to feel, oh my God, you know, these kids will drop dead, you know, trying to do all of this. But it was his way of spurring you on, you know, to that you can do more than you think you're doing, you know, you've got much more inside of you. So if you look at Manmathan that way, he was a very good HR person, but very harsh, very harsh.
His life seems to be a long search for something, something deeper in life. he kept on moving from here to there, all over. And even after coming to Anjani Sen, it doesn't seem as if he had arrived at his destination. Mm-hmm. What do you think was driving him? What kind of vision was driving him? Can it be summarized in few lines or?
He was a very restless soul. And I think he is best described as a Karma Yogi. A Karma Yogi's work is never over, you know, it's from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next. He was, in all of these things of harshness and things, he was harshest on himself. So one way of looking at it would be is that he was a very restless soul. But one never got the impression that he was in search of the miraculous and he didn't know what the miraculous was. He wasn't a show-off in any way. I never ever knew that Manmatha knew his shlokas and Sanskrit and this and that and the other. I never knew those things about him, other than in a practical situation when he's absolutely traumatizing a Panditji in the middle of a puja where he's berating him. You don't have this consciousness to wash your own bottom. And you're daring to try to say this from, what are you buckling, you know? Do you think we don't understand what you're saying? Baad mein humne usse pucha, aap jaante hain ye saare chakkar, you know, he just gave me a filthy look. So that epitomized to me Manmatha was that he knew these more sensitive sensitivities of life, but he never showed off about it. He never in a bhashan would use Sanskrit slokas and this and that, never. But he was knowledgeable about it. It was an internalized thing, that's why I feel. But he was not necessarily in search of anything. He said it the way he saw it. So the way he saw it was not always very pleasant. And it didn't matter who was on the other side of the camera. He would tell them straight where it was happening. So, you know, it's very embarrassing and kind of thing, and but he said it as he saw it. And so that gave you the impression that he's a very restless soul. He was always talking to you, sort of taking off on his next stride, like, oh, just a second, you know. And he was very, what is the word, electric in those kind of ways, you know. Or Mercury, you try to catch Manmathan, you can't pick up Mercury, you know. He was off on the next tamasha. It was exhausting. It was exhausting. So the many little things that he would show, I can remember sort of walking with him on the way to somewhere or the other, and he'd pick up some tiny plant and say, if you get very tired, just recognize this and chew on these leaves. You know. So you had to learn as at the speed of which life is just going. Now he's going to give you a jadi booty education in it. Chalte hue isko thoda patti do chaar khayenge, kita khayenge. Arey ye bahut acha hota hai baal ke liye. Whatever. So he was on very practical person.
Would you like to reminisce about some funny moments with Manmathan?
Yes, funny moments meaning that in all of this imagery that you might get of a very stern, a very grouchy, a very angry person, Swamiji's sense of humor was the kind of sense of humor that when he would laugh at something or with something, I've several times seen his chair go ulta and him go rolling down the steps. That kind of laughter, you know. So even in laughter, he would take the fullest pleasure.
Some incident?
Again, I don't know how much I can say it on camera, but I remember this whole bunch of very dowager professor types who came from Delhi University. And on a visit. And the ashram in those days was still very much basic, not like 5-star I've made it today. And this bunch of, the image I have is this bunch of university eggheads, 10 or 15 years, I'm in conversation with Manmathan. So I'm looking from the back of Swamiji. And then some mystery comes and makes some kind of stupid comment about some work or the other. And Manmathan obviously went from 0 degrees to over 4 million degrees Fahrenheit and told the mystery what he could do, or what Manmathan would do to him, which basically said that the rod you have in your hand, I would stick it where you don't want it stuck and I'll pull it out of your own mouth. Kaisi bol rahe hain isko, can't remember, but the imagery you get. And when he said it, and it had slipped from his mouth in mystery language, in the crudest form, he realized where he was in front of all of these Dowager University professors from Delhi. And but turning back to the Delhi group, he got his composure, and then he was a very charming human being when he wanted to be. Charming, he said, you have to speak to people in the language they understand. Because there was horror on the face of these university professionals to hear a supposed sacred man even use such words, you know, or imagery. But he managed to calm them down. There was very little per se joking or humor. Swamiji didn't much, but if he laughed at something or something made him laugh, I've seen him many times tilt his chair over the wrong way and fall with his lungi and legs in the air, kind of laughing at things. So, yes, he knew how to laugh. But puja and humor and some of the more gentle things in life, he had those emotions, you know. And many, many times I would see him with the children being very stern, you know. But that didn't come easy to him, you know. You could see him instead wanting to put his arms around this child, but instead give him a mouthful of abuse sort of thing, you know. So sometimes that was troubling. But I think that was nothing as a hang-up or anything like that.